to be in Christ is a reality that we have to live by whilst we're on earth. Hallelujah. Come to the other people and say, today is your post-resurrection agenda, and you are not permitted to fail. God can, God will, does not exist in my vocabulary, because I know God's done it.
The shackles and set the path of
after
free.
All I've been through, the only way out of this is another victory.
And it's gonna spread. Send us some rainbow word in this house today.
Now, experience the bliss of heaven as Pastor Juan Abraham leads Free Church with the sword of the Spirit. It's time to hear the word of God according to the pattern.
Meetings are taking place hand back to back, or is a place where, you know, the lamb, the name's working and the blind sees. Or some of you think, you know, the greatest testimony or manifestation of God is when people start to speak in tongues and all that. But it boils down to one thing. All that is wrapped up in something called the word of God. Hallelujah. So if you're looking for the greatest manifestation of God, then you're looking for an introduction or a display of the word of God. When you introduce the word of God into something, or you introduce the voice of God into something, which is the word of God, you have introduced the greatest dimension that God could ever bring into that situation. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
I'm very glad about that. John's appraisal of the creation story tells a lot about the power in the word of God. We saw the formless and shapeless earth after God had created them. After God had created it, it was mad, or it was fought or destroyed, you know, by the devil. And so God came, you know, in verse 2 and began to, you know, reboot about what needed to be done. And if you notice, God didn't put his hand on his head and, you know, he's wondering how is it going to happen, how is it going to this, how are we going to start over again? I put so much in the first creation. You know, that's exactly the way some of us react when we get to a point where things are not working, or things get mad in our heads, get sport in our heads. You know, but God introduced his voice and it activated another creation. Hallelujah. He introduced, and according to John, his appraisal of creation is different. You know, he talks about every other thing, but he said in John chapter 1 that in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and without him was not anything made that was made. So everything that you saw in that place in Genesis was created by the Word of God. Hallelujah. God didn't touch anything. God didn't design anything. God just spoke everything. Hallelujah. And if creation was about speaking, then that means we can speak creation. Hallelujah. Into them. Hallelujah. We can call those things that be not as though they were. Hallelujah. So the Word of God can do what God can do. Look at somebody and say, the Word of God can do what God can do. And of course, you saw how Jesus came to the world, and the Bible says that we beheld the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. You know, and he was referring to the Word in the same chapter, talking about, you know, said there was a man that came from above. He wasn't talking about John. And he said John was a witness of that light, that same light that lighted every man in the world. And he said, and we beheld the glory of the begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So John is telling us about John, about Jesus. So when he saw Jesus, he beheld the glory of God. Hallelujah.
God.
He beheld the glory. When he saw Jesus, he didn't see a Palestinian adult. He just saw the glory of God, full of grace and truth. All right. And of course, that was God introducing his word, which is Jesus, into the world that was destroyed by sin and death. Hallelujah. In Adam, we all fell. In Adam, the creation of God, man became a victim of sin and a slave of sin. And as a result, he looked hopeless. He didn't have hope. And there was a great wall, bigger than China wall, of partition between him and God, because there was no peace anymore because of his nature of unrighteousness. And so as a result, God introduced his word at the cross. Hallelujah. And when he introduced his word at the cross, restored. So that's a child restoration.
Restoration.
Restored the relationship that Adam had with God from the Garden of Eden. And the Hebrew author confirms and says that, you know, the wall of partition has been broken, and he is our peace who has broken down every wall. Hallelujah. So now God interests. So you find God introducing his word in the worst situation. He introduces his word in the beginning and created again. And it was beautiful. God says everything he created was good and was good and it was good. And then man was destroyed. The best and the pinnacle of his creation was destroyed by sin and death. And yet the only thing God could introduce was his word. And that's why the greatest manifestation of God is when you have his word in display over certain situation in your life. Hallelujah. God told me this morning, he said, they can't experience the power of the voice if they cannot totally rely on it. Hallelujah. They can't experience the power, the efficacy, the power of the voice of my word if they cannot totally rely on it. Hallelujah. So those whose heart doubts the word of God cannot experience the greatest manifestation of God in their lives, because his word is the one that introduces or displays his greatest manifestation. And so when we push his word away or disbelieve his word or doubt his word, we find ourselves in a place where we have rejected the word and we have rejected the greatest manifestation of God in our lives. In Jeremiah chapter 18, we read, I believe last week, about Jeremiah, a prophet who got told to go to the potter's house where God will cause him to hear his voice or his word. And when he got there, he saw the potter make vessels. And the first vessel marred or got spoiled or got destroyed for some reason. Maybe a wind blew for too much, or someone, you know, just triggered it or something. The Bible didn't tell us what caused it. But what the Bible said was the first creation was marred. The first creation was destroyed. The first step looks like a failure. Then he said the potter made it again. God told in chapter 19, you will read about the same word, how that vessel, the potter, that the potter was making was to be used for something. Hallelujah. So God was taking his prophet to that place so that he would understand the power of the word of God. I might be just excited that your end is not your failure seasons, that there is another season after that. And God's manifestation can come into that failure season and turn it around. How many of you are just excited about that? I've watched the word of God translate or transform my failure seasons into the best season, praise the Lord. I've become habitual to the mindset that when I fail today, that means a success for me tomorrow. Because failure cannot be the end of all this. Look at someone say, failure cannot be the end of all this. Hallelujah. Now, he didn't say in the realm, the potter, if you will notice, did not stay in the realm of the marred experience. And that's what I want to deal with tonight. He didn't stay in the realm of the broken experience. He didn't stay in the realm of the hopeless experience. Just like God, he looked at the shapelessness and the formlessness in Genesis and spoke his word, introduced his voice, and then the voice activated another creation, the best creation, the best thing that you could ever meet or see. Even God himself said it was good. So that tells you that God is not moved by what caused the failure. The Bible didn't really tell us much about how the formlessness came about. All right, but he told us how God dealt with it. Hallelujah. And so the potter is having the same spirit. God told us that people will operate in the same potter spirit this month. And I just really want to deal with that. What's this potter spirit? The potter spirit here is talking about how the potter, he looked at it. He didn't cry about it. He didn't shout about it. The Bible didn't tell us how his face was. And really, frankly, all those things can be done. As long as you're introducing the word of God at the end of the day. You can cry about it. You can shout about it. You can frown your face if you want. All that still doesn't have any consequence or anything. But at the end of the day, after all the tantrums of unbelief, you better come back to faith and introduce the greatest manifestation of God, which is his word. Hallelujah. And that was the Polar Spirit. He got there when they got mad in his hand. I don't know how many things have gotten spoiled in your hands. I don't know how many, you know, a lot of times we claim that we have faith and we don't expect anything to get spoiled. But I don't think so. I think we are living in a fallen world where it's storm and boisterous wind will blow sometimes in a way that it shouldn't blow. And like Jesus, even though we are the Son of God, we will find ourselves in the boat on a very crazy and annoyed sea. And then, but what are you going to do about it? Look at us and say, what are you going to do about it? So the question tonight is, what happens between the time that the vessel in your hand, the ministry in your hand, the calling of God upon your life, your project, your marriage, your academics, what happens between the time that it got mad in your head or got destroyed in your hands and you look like a failure and the time that you have to pick it up again and introduce the Word of God and mold a better you? Hallelujah. What happens? There is a timeline and all of us will have to go through that. If God went through that, then we are going to go through that. And when God came to the scene, He didn't put His hand on His head. He introduced His Word. He didn't say, I would never create something that would get spoiled. No, he just went on to fix it. And He fixed it through His voice. He said, let there be light, and there was light. Let there be moon, there was moon. You know, let the seed, the tree spring up. Let the seed bear and plant, give birth according to their kinds. Let there be monsters in the sea. Let there be, and He spoke those things without touching anything. Hallelujah. And they all came into reality because God and His Word are the same. Say with me, He said, the Word of God can do what God can do. So what happens to you as a believer when something fails in your hand? You know, late last month, I saw mad hands. You know, and God began to deal with me about the word for the month. You know, how His Word is going to rebuild and He's going to bring it, you know, to future. He's going to bring it back to a re-execution, a resurgence, a resurrection of dead things and all of that. But, you know, according to the experience of the porter, God told me none of us can escape that. We're going to get to a point where it looks like our faith is bringing us to a point of failure after all. We're going to get to a point where we've started something and then we are molding it and we know what we're doing and we put so much in it and it looks like it failed all of a sudden. You know, but the plan of God for us is not to stay at that realm. Praise the Lord. There is a realm called the voice activated realm. Hallelujah. There's a realm that you can use the voice of God to activate the next level of creation or manifestation in your life. Hallelujah. What happens in between the time the vessel breaks in your hand and the time that you have to decide to make it again and make it better, because the steps of a righteous man gets brighter and brighter. And so one thing is for sure, the voice comes, a voice will definitely come to you the moment the vessel breaks in your hand. You know, many of us are not acquainted with this, but we are a victim of this anyways, because it exists in the realm of the spirit. There's a voice that comes to you when you fail. There's a voice that comes to you when you fall. There's a voice that comes to you when something breaks in your hand. There's a voice that comes to you, the voice of condemnation, the voice of failure, the voice that tells you it could never be better than what it is. I don't know who made that happen. I don't know whether it was a distraction. Maybe the potter was looking at something while this got spoiled in his hands. I don't know whether it was because he couldn't pay his bills that it got spoiled in his hands. I don't know whether because some things happened and he was shaky, some earthquake-ish things in his life. Whatever the situation was, the potter's spirit does not end his pottery in the season of failure. He takes it to the season of success, a remolding, a re-execution of God's grace in that thing, so that people can tell that it was God, because it's coming back alive. And my word to someone tonight is that you can still come back alive. Hallelujah. My word to someone here tonight is that you can still do what? You can still come back alive. Could you hear me preach that to someone beside you and say, you are coming back alive. I know that for sure. Hallelujah. So the voice of the broken vessel is another voice. When you look at the vessel that just got broken in your hand, you, You are hearing so much from that person. He's telling you, you are not capable of fixing me. He's telling you, I'm so bad that nothing can fix me. He's telling you, you better move on to another job. He's telling you, maybe you need another fix. Maybe you should try something else. You know, because the potter's spirit, you know, has to deal with the voice of the vessel that broke in his hand. He has to deal with it. He has to look at it in the face and say, I know you got broken in my hand. I know you cannot, you know, I know it seems like this is the end, but you got to learn that I am the potter and you are the clay. And that's one thing somebody here tonight has to know, that whatever got broken in your life, in your hand, whatever project that you started that didn't finish, or whatever anointing of God upon your life that sees that you are not operating in it anymore, or whatever situation that you are surrounded by, they are in the realm of the clay, and you are in the realm of the potter. And because you are not on the same realm with them, the clay, the Bible says, cannot speak better of itself. Hallelujah. And that means I have the authority to introduce a new water, or maybe mortar, maybe another style, maybe a little stirring. But at the end of the day, this clay cannot determine what I do. I determine what the clay becomes. Hallelujah. Look at someone say, you can determine what everything comes out with. You can determine the outcome of things by the word of God. That's what the potter spirit does. He brings you to a level of the potter. And he brings what you have gone through that failed in your hand at the level of the clay. I've learned to put everything that failed in my life at the level of the clay. So that I am the potter and I have the authority to change it. I can bring another style. I can change it and bring another shape. But I'm not going to give up, because the clay, talking about the job, the clay, talking about the ministry, the clay, talking about the marriage, whatever it is that looked like I failed in, I'm going to put myself in the position of the potter, and everything I failed in comes to a position of the clay, and then I have the power over it. And so the problem is, many potters are not aware of their power over the clay that God's poured in their hands. They're not aware that they have the power to make that clay come back alive, come back to where it ought to be, praise the Lord. They forget, because the voice of the clay that God's poured, the vessel that God's poured, the job that God's poured, the business that didn't work, the project that failed, everything looks like they are speaking so much and they are loud in your ears. And you can only hear that you are a failure. You can only hear that you can't fix this. You can only hear that you are not that person. You can only hear that this is what it is and all of that. And then fear begins to come. Terror is in your mind. Your faith begins to reduce. Then you become weakened. And you become one that doesn't pray. Then you are not looking forward to something good anymore. Then you find yourself in a state where you are frustrated and the word of God is not in your mouth. Hallelujah. And so the voice of the broken vessel, the broken life, broken relationships, broken businesses, broken projects, broken things around you begins to tell you it's impossible, you can't do it, you can't fix it, because this is what it is and that is what it is. Hallelujah. And so discouragement comes and they say it's over, you can't make it now, this is not the time to, you know what, just go find yourself another job, move to another city. You can't do church here. Hallelujah. You can't try that here. That kind of business doesn't work here. It doesn't happen that way. You can't just come from that place and then expect this and that to happen. But look at someone saying, a voice activated dimension awaits you. And so Adam, you look at Adam, for instance, Adam, the Bible says there was a voice that walked in the garden, and that was the voice of God. And then he would come in the cool of the day, and then they would have a fellowship, and then, you know, of course, this particular day in chapter 3, you know, I believe verse 8 there, about the same voice hollered, you know, at Adam and said, where are you? Where are thou? You know, that's one of the things that I realized, that the voice always say to us, you know, after every time we fail. I've looked at and researched some of the stories in the Bible, and I realized the first thing he asks us is, where are you? Where are you? Why are you here? It questions our stand and our posture about failure. It questions where we stand. Are you still standing as the potter when the clay got poured in your hands? Or are you standing as a clay, you know, in front of a clay? Hallelujah. And so God asked Adam and said, where are you? and Adam because he could not discern the voice activation of the Holy Ghost. He could not discern that when the voice is introduced, there's usually what you call the good news, the gospel. Hallelujah. You know, Adam didn't know. Adam thought that God was coming to judge him. Adam thought because he had failed and God didn't have a choice. But God had a choice. Hallelujah. The voice that asked Adam, "Where art thou?" was the voice that was already prepared to judge the serpent. I said the voice that was asking Adam was the voice that was prepared to shout and holler that the devil will have a seed and Jesus, a greater seed, will bruise his head. Hallelujah. It was the voice that was going to give the woman the liberty to be saved again. It was the voice that was going to bring man into the lost glory. It was the voice that would bring the descendant of Adam into glory, bringing many sons back to glory. It was the voice of a resurgence. It was a voice of resurrection. It was a voice of hope. The voice wasn't coming to tell you how bad Eden was going to be. It was not a voice coming with judgment in it. It was not a voice coming with hopelessness in it. It was not a voice coming to judge what you did wrong or did right. It was a voice coming to coming to replace the fig tree. Hallelujah. The leaves of fig that you put under you and you have wrapped up yourself with the wrong mantle and you have wrapped up yourself with the mistakes and the reality of the mistakes you've made in the past. It was the voice that was going to bring things alive. But Adam did not know that that voice could activate righteousness through him. Adam didn't know that voice could activate another seed of man, of woman, that would bruise the head of the seed, of the serpent. He didn't know that the voice that spoke to him was the voice that was capable of activating a new creation made after the holiness and the righteousness of God. He didn't know that that voice was to activate something better. He thought that voice was coming to analyze the spoiled clay, the mad ministry, the mistakes that he had made. But the voice wasn't coming to talk about that. He was coming to talk about the glory that was in front of his failure. And I wish somebody here tonight will hear a voice after they have failed. And this is the problem with us. We hear many voices the moment we fail. The point of failure and the point of making it again is a very critical time in the life of a believer. Because at that point, you begin to hear a lot of things. A lot of voices begin to tell you that you are doing something wrong. A lot of the voices in the world, there are many voices in the world. And they will come to you as the porter. It's going to say, "So what are you going to do now?" It's going to ask you, "So what are you going to make again? Are you going to make the bottle again? Or are you going to make a plate again? What's the shape of what you want now? I don't think you can achieve it. There's no more water, no more mortar. No one knows. You're not as good as you think you are." And that voice become elevated, gains ascendancy in our mind, and then our spirit become so unempowered that everything makes a lot of sense in the world, and the word of God does not. Hallelujah. And so Adam said, "I heard your voice and I was afraid." And he said, "I heard your voice and I was afraid." And you would have stopped there. But God replied him and said, "Adam, you listen to the voice of your wife." Praise the Lord. You see, there's always a voice that is contending with his voice. There's always the voice of son, because the wife represents the person that made him fall. The wife represents the weaker vessel or the weaker place or the weaker part of him through which the devil came through. Hallelujah. He was, the wife reminded him of a lot of things. And so he didn't want to tell God. He said, "When I heard your voice, I was afraid." You know, sometimes you get smarter with God and we don't want to tell him the way things are as if he doesn't know everything. You know, when God asks you this and you're asking, you should know he knows everything. So just say the truth. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I've never heard God in that level that God is asking you questions. So you better just say the truth, because this is God we're talking about here. All right? And so he said, I was afraid when I heard your voice and it stopped. God said, you didn't finish the statement. You heard my voice and you were afraid because you have listened to the voice of your wife. The Bible unfortunately uses the word hearkened to the voice of your wife. He said, you hearkened to the voice of your wife. The word here is shawar. And he talks about to hearken is not just to listen. To hearken is to actually listen with an obedient spirit. In other words, I'm willing to take whatever you say. And that's why he couldn't tell her, baby, we're not that hungry for fruit right now. Maybe we should go for some vegetables. You know, we don't want no fruit right now. You know, he couldn't tell her the way he was. You know, because, you know, he obeyed what he, you know, what she was bringing to the table. So he was intentional. That's why Paul said, no, he wasn't deceived. Don't use the word deception when it comes to Adam, because he knew what he was doing. He intentionally allowed it because he believed in the voice of his wife more than the voice of God. He had a decision to make. And I wish I could tell someone tonight that there's always a decision that you got to make. Your prosperity is a decision. Your victory is going to be your decision. I know that you have failed, and I know that there are challenges all around you. And I know sometimes it's hard to paddle the canoe towards the boisterous winds. But at the end of the day, you have to understand that you are the one to make the victorious decision. And that decision lies in the amount of the word and the voice that is in your spirit. Hallelujah. Are you hearing what I'm saying tonight? So God said to Abraham, you hearken to the voice of your wife. To hearken means to listen diligently, to listen attentively, to listen with intention to obey, to listen with an obedient spirit, to be attentive, to give ear, you know, to something, to put focus on something. So what we're saying here is, you know, Adam had meditated attentively. You know, he had given ear to what the woman said. He knew that God said you shouldn't, but then he went ahead to do it because he had looked at it and told himself, this is what I want to do. And that's why the believer thinks that God's going to show up one night and say, don't make that decision. And you want to go that way, so you can't go that way. You can't go that way. No, you can't go that way. No, God doesn't act like that. You want to go that way? Yes, it's your choice. Hallelujah. But if you want to go that way, whatever happens to you that way, I have the power to bring you back standing on your feet. That's my place, but I'm not going to stop you from going that way. A lot of times we act so smart, and we try to meditate on the voice in the world. And we try to put it beside the word of God. Hallelujah. You know, sometimes, you know, it comes to a lot of things. For instance, God said, give and it shall be given. And then you have this couple of shoes that you just got. And someone says, and God says, give it. You know, that's not logical. That doesn't make any sense. Because God's not gonna buy another shoe for you, right? You are wrong, because God's one that got you the last one, praise the Lord, and he's going to get you even better ones, praise the Lord. I've learned to give out the best so that I can get a better one, praise the Lord. And you got what I'm saying? Because at the end of the day, there is coming about the best of the best, praise the Lord. So even if I give you the best right now, I'm expecting the best of the best. And that's why God gave his best, praise the Lord. And that's why he expects the best from us. That's why David said, I won't give the Lord anything that doesn't cost me. That's why the king's worship was rejected by God. Because God wants the best. He has given his best, and so he expects the best from us. Praise the Lord. And so Enoch found himself struggling with the voice of God and the voice of his wife. And like some of us, we are struggling with the voice of God and the voice of the broken vessel. We are struggling with the voice of God and the voice of the failure. We are struggling with the voice of God and the voice of the rejection and shame and ostracism and whatever had happened to us before now. But the Lord has a word for someone tonight. And there's about to be an activation of a new creation in your life. Because God is going to create that thing that was spoiled, that thing that was stolen, that thing that wasn't taken from you, that thing that you failed in, that you know in your knower that you failed in. God has the ability to bring them back through the power of his word. Look at someone say, it's going to get better. Hallelujah. And so at the end of the day, you know, we get bored about the failures that we have gone through, and then we don't want to hear anybody say anything about God. The last word we want to hear is God's going to fix it, because it looks like we are losing our mind. How many of you have believed God's word to the extent that it looks like you are really looking losing your mind? You know, not just that your friends are a little bit on the extreme. You really think you might be losing your mind. How many of you feel that way? Because God doesn't speak to our mind. God doesn't speak to our mind. And some of us add in our heart. I heard when he said, you know, today in Hebrews chapter 10, he said, if you hear his voice today, do not harden your heart. You know, so the word harden becomes the opposite of hearken. Praise the Lord. Is it that I hearken to the voice of the Lord, or I harden myself against the voice of the Lord? And it says, today if you hear his voice, in John chapter 10, he said, my sheep hear my voice, and they know me, and they obey me. Praise the Lord. My sheep hear my voice, they know me, and they obey me. So when you hear the voice of the Lord, it's, you know, the word here is the word hear here, you know, is a Greek word that actually means the same thing as hearken. When you hearken, not just to hear, because a lot of people hear things in the church that they don't do just when they step outside the walls of this church. Hallelujah. You tell them something and they just step out, that they're already doing quite. So we're not talking about that kind of hearing. We're talking about hearken to the voice of the Lord. He said, if you hearken to my voice, I mean, my sheep hearken to my voice. They hearken to my voice. They hearken, they listen attentively, and they listen with the intention to obey. They listen with an obedient spirit. Hallelujah. Look at someone say, today,
today
I decide
not to harden
my heart
against the will of God,
but to hearken
to
the voice
of the Lord.
Hallelujah. Now in 1 Kings chapter 19 that we read, we find Elijah, who obviously was going through the same thing the porter went through in Jeremiah 18. Here he found himself, after doing a lot of things for God, he found himself, you know, experiencing a mad situation, just like the porter. He found himself, you know, this was just after the previous chapter was just when he prayed and there was blackness in the heavens and there was rain on the earth, and the whole country experienced rain after 3 years. And so it was a marvelous thing, it was a glorious thing. And then he found himself being threatened by a voice, and that was the voice of Jezebel. He found himself wondering, how am I going to move on when this voice begins to come? Now, I realized that failure is a season in our lives that speaks. And I realized that success is also a season in our lives that speaks. Hallelujah. Success can speak fear just as much as failure can speak fear. Sometimes you find yourself being promoted to a place where you don't think you can handle it. Sometimes you find yourself, God launching your anointing in the world, and you are just scared, silently somewhere here, that what if I fail in the midst of all this? Sometimes it's another thing that God, another greater dimension of glory that God is calling you to. And you're just wondering, how am I going to get the funds or capital or people that will do this? How am I supposed to convince people to, you know, I don't even know what I'm talking about. So success is not necessarily something that I always say, yeah, you got it. Sometimes it's like that for some of us, but sometimes it's all the way around. Hallelujah. Here was a man who had gone through a lot of things, but the problem with the prophet is he expected that all these glorious things would get the people to come out and worship the God of Israel. He expected that after seeing the wonders of God at the mountain, after seeing the blackness and the glory of prayer and how God answers the prayer of a righteous man and all of that, he thought that men and women would come and say, you know what, I want your God. I love your God. You know, he had slain all the 450 prophets of Baal, so he didn't expect anyone to be hiding if they wanted to be part of God. He told him, you got to choose this day who you are going to follow. And so after all that, there was no congregant. And sometimes you find yourself in a place where God has called you and given you something to do, but you are surrounded by people who have not tasted the glory that is to come. And so they react to it as if it was nothing. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Trust me, there's no frustration that is bigger than that in life. Hallelujah. You know, and at that point he found himself and he saw himself as a failure. He thought, okay, so all of this was for nothing? And sometimes you find yourself as a child of God. You have prayed and fasted, and you have put so much energy in something,
But somehow it came back to you like you didn't do anything. Praise the Lord. Sometimes it was all night that you got to pray and fast and do some things, and you are ministering and it looks like you didn't do anything. Sometimes you've called the sheep and you have prayed and called his or her name in the place of prayer, and yet the sheep is the only one that doesn't come to church. Come on, am I talking to you? Sometimes you've declared the word about that job, then you got there and you were not given that job. Sometimes it's whatever it is around us, praise the Lord. And that was where the prophet found himself. He found himself in a place where he had to either doubt, you know, that God was real, or because he was real at the mountain, but somehow I don't think he's really real, that real now. Because I'm wondering why he wouldn't do something about this voice. Praise the Lord. So Jezebel sent an SMS to him and said, "Prophet, thank you for killing 450 prophets of mine. You have shined, and I thank you." She didn't mention the place of rain, even though Ahab would have told her, and everybody would have known that there was rain until they got into Jezreel. And she didn't mention that, but she mentioned the fact that there wasn't. How many of you just know that the devil knows how to go to your past and take out the baddest thing that you did just to make you get scared of the future prepared for you? You know, he just brings it out to your face and says, "You, now, no, have you forgotten?" Praise the Lord. You know, and at the end of the day, she said, "Tomorrow, I'm no more queen if I don't kill you." I think that's the greatest threat anybody can receive from the devil. He said, "By this time tomorrow," because we're talking about 24 hours. He said, "In 24 hours, I'm going to take you out." He said, "You're going to be with them." Praise the Lord. He said, "And if I don't," say, "I'm not Jezebel." Praise the Lord. Or Jay-Z. Whatever it is. "I'm going to kill you. I'm going to use every weapon that I've got. I'm going to kill you." And I wonder, as at the time, the first thing failed in your hand as the prophet of God, and the time God will have you pick it up again, how did you entertain the voice of the devil? How did you entertain the voice of Jezebel? And just that window period, the prophet acted as though he wasn't the one that called the rains down. He acted as though God was never and had never been with him. He acted as though even the famine was not prophesied by him. He acted as though God never did it. And that's exactly where some of us are. We react to situations that failed in our hands as though God had never been faithful before that time. Because of that, we stop coming to church, we stop praying, we stop doing stuff. We really just don't like God no more. You know, I just, you know, for some people, the moment they fail, church is the problem why they fail. That tells me that every success that you have outside of church is a failure. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Is a failure. And we don't need your tithes and offering and money and whatever you think you have. Just open the door, let him go. Hallelujah. Sometimes for you to shut down the voice of Jezebel, you have to open the door for her to leave. Because as long as she's around, you see the army, know the NASA and the US Army, they know this. They know that words is powerful. So when they're about to kill you and you're telling them, you know, "You're gonna die." They put something in your mouth because words work. It activates something in you. No matter how they are in training, they could kill him, but just like you said that, they are thinking, "Does he have any information before we kill him?" Because when you kill a man with information, then you're no good soldier. you got to imprison him. That's all we need. The mission was not to kill him. Hallelujah. And they know, the cooper knows that the voice works, so he's like, "I'm gonna kill you. You think you can kill me? All right, kill me." He's saying all he's scared, but he's saying it to you so that you are scared. Hallelujah. So Jezebel said, "This time tomorrow I'm gonna kill you." But we serve a God that 24 hours is nothing to us. 24 hours of threat in your life can be cancelled. 6 hours stress can be cancelled. I don't know what they said would happen to you if this does not happen in 24 hours. I don't know what they said. I don't know how many debtors or how many people you have, and I tell you, "You don't pay me tomorrow." That's a lie.
Yes.
At the end of the day, Nigeria owes. At the end of the day, Lagos is owing. At the end of the day, nobody's killing Lagos. How much more you? Hallelujah. I'm not talking about those that borrowed money to buy shoes. Okay? Yes. I have to put a disclaimer after this sermon. This sermon is for. Praise the Lord. Come on, are you catching something here?
Yes, sir.
24 hours. How many hours do you have left? Look at two of us and say, "How many hours do you have left?" Look at him and say, I know you've been threatened. I know you've been threatened. But how many have, did they say you have not? And some of you have projected in front of you. But look at someone and say, how many days do you have left? God's going to do it. God's going to fix it. Hallelujah. So the voice of Jezebel became loud. And the prophet said, you know what? I got to give myself some brain. And the moment you begin to give yourself some brain, you begin to lose your faith. And so brain began to act. And he's strategizing. Then he found himself under a juniper tree. Now, a juniper tree is a broom-like thing that represents a tree, a broom tree that represents yoke. Praise the Lord. And the prophet sat under that tree for a long time. And the angel of the Lord came and said, you know what, you got to get up, you got to eat, because the journey in front of you is heavy and it's a lot. You got to eat now. And so he brought food for you, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You see how God can sustain you. First of all, God wanted him alive because of something that he wanted to make him do. He wanted him to see the end of this. That it's not going to end Jezebel's way. It's going to end according to my words.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. And that's why no matter the threat of the devil over your life today, no matter what he has said concerning you today, God is bringing bread and he's feeding you with strength to go through that season so that you can face what God has for you. Because sometimes it doesn't come with the result. It only comes with the strength. As I said, don't I walk through the valley. He's not going to take the valley out, but he's going to take me through it. But I'm going to need some strength. And so the angel said, you got to eat and twice again. You know, a lot of times we pretend and say, no, I'm in my shape. And I got this. No. Sometimes even as the greatest man of God, or whatever you think you are, you'll find yourself in a place where you become so dry because the first vessel has failed in your hands. Your hand, this man is having a mad ministry experience. He was having a ministry in his hand that looked like it had been spoiled and there was no hope for the future. It looked like God was not going to do anything about it, but God had a plan and it was his voice. Hallelujah. So when you begin to move, God told me this morning, from juniper tree. And of course, the Bible says that he moved from that place and he journeyed 40 days, 40 nights. But you will not, you will never understand until you come to verse 13 or verse 12. The Bible says, one of the verses, you know, that he journeyed and went to a cave. He went into a cave. He went into a cave. Oh, I wish I had time tonight, you know. You know, he went into a cave. Now, Elijah, the Bible says, the angel said to him, you got journey in front of you. And now you got to journey from here to here and all that. So he was going to go 40 days, 40 nights, all right? Then he journeyed 40 days, 40 nights, then found himself in a cave. Now, a cave is a dark place. A cave is a place where there is no light. A cave is a place where whatever decision you are making there, you are making it based on the atmosphere that is dark. And every decision made in the dark does not reflect the glory of God. That's why God said, let there be light first. I don't want to see no darkness. Just put light everywhere, then I can do what I got to do. When we make decisions in the dark, we're not making the right decision. And so what this man did was he journeyed from the juniper tree, a place where he was sitting under the yoke. The Bible says that the yoke shall be destroyed by the anointing or because of the anointing. You know, that's an image of the egg being thrown at a mountain, a sedimentary or metamorphic rock. You throw an egg towards the mountain, then you see the mountain doesn't even feel jack. Praise the Lord. But yet, the Bible didn't tell us to sit under the juniper tree. It didn't tell us to sit under the yoke. Praise the Lord. It told us to break that yoke because the anointing to break it is upon our lives. And that's what some of us do at that point when the vessel gets broken in our hand. What we do is we find a very cute juniper tree. Hallelujah. And we sit down there and we are trying to get a self-pity party and stuff, and we are trying to tell ourselves what we did wrong and all of that. And he sat under what is supposed to break. Somebody here tonight is sitting under a tree, a yoke that you are meant to break. The child of God has not been called to stand or to sit under the yoke. He's called with an anointing that breaks yokes and removes burdens. Hallelujah. And by the anointing in your life, the yoke is going to be broken. broken. But the voice of Jezebel was now contesting with the consciousness of his anointing. And so he allowed that voice, you know, louder and louder in him, in his mind. And so he found himself, you know, reckless. And he found himself getting ready to kill himself because he would rather die than face the shame that was to come. He didn't want anyone to hear that Elijah, the king, or the prophet was hung or was killed by Jezebel, that stupid woman or something. And so he didn't want that rep, so he would rather die strong. You know, so they would find him dead somewhere and say, maybe it was God that killed him. So he had this logic in his head, praise the Lord. And God said, I'm not killing you, but I'm preparing you. I got one word for someone tonight. You're not going to die, but God's going to prepare you for tomorrow. I know that you are so tired about many things around you right now, but hear the voice of your destiny. God is preparing you, is strengthening you, because there is more in front of you than behind you. And because there is more in front of you, more challenges will come and more demons will come. But if you can go and trample over this one, you can trample over them. And so let this experience be an experiment for the future. That if I took down the Goliath 3 years ago, then I can take down Goliath 7 years to come. Are you hearing it? So I've learned to use my experience as a training ground. I don't ever look at myself and say, maybe God didn't know. God called me. No, no, I got a future that's beautiful. No, there is a plan for my life. You know, I just need to fix this. And even when the solution will not come like a magic, I wish it will, but I got strength in his word. And I can go through and come out. When you move from the juniper tree into the cave, you have not moved on a faith journey. Faith journey does not move from the juniper tree to the cave. He moved from the juniper tree to the place of victory, to the top of the mountain, to the place where God wants you to be. But the prophet moved from the juniper tree and found himself, you know, in the cave. You have not made a faith journey until, if you have only moved from juniper tree to the cave. Hallelujah. And so he began to wail and talk and say all kinds of things. And he said, God, I want you to kill me. And because of all of this, the Bible says that, you know, in verse 10, I don't know if you have verse 10 on the screen for me. In verse 10, he replied. He said, the Lord said, the word of the Lord came to him. He said, where are you? And he said, I've been very zealous. I've been very zealous about what you called me to do. He said, but I'm the only one. Everyone has rejected your covenant. They have torn down your altars. You know, sometimes from where I stand, I feel that way. But the truth is, there's always a remnant somewhere. Hallelujah. There are sons and daughters, according to the Bible, that will uphold the thing and make you see that God is not a liar. Praise the Lord. The Bible said, let every man be a liar. Let every man be a liar. As long as man is connected to that problem, it can be a lie at the end of the day. Praise the Lord. God can turn it around. Why is it going to be a lie? Man is so powerful, but God is more powerful. So it's going to be a lie because we serve a God that can make their truth a lie. We serve a God that can make their confidence their weakness. We serve a God that can make their success their sorrow. Are you hearing this? He said, you are not like them. He said, they are walking on a slippery ground. They can fall anytime from now. But you are a tree planted by the rivers of the living water. Sometimes they pass by you and they didn't see no fruit. But he said, in your season, you will bring forth fruit. And he said, your fruit will not wither. In other words, in the moment you come into this, the devil will say, no, don't go there anymore. They will come in another way. But the Bible said, the Lord will raise the standard. And that standard is in your spirit. Put your hand on your belly. I said, there is a standard in my spirit that the Lord is raising. Say, I'm going to win this one. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. He says, arise. Look at someone, say, arise and eat. The journey is too great. Hallelujah. So though he left the juniper tree, but he was not still going to the right place. I've seen people leave the juniper tree when I talk to them in the place of counsel, but they are not still going to the right place. They still go straight to the cave. They still go straight to the place of darkness. Yes, they've moved on, but they have not really moved on. Yes, they have said, I'm not, this is it, but they have not really, really moved on. And they move from from juniper tree to cave, and they're still making decisions in the dark. They are not enlightening their spirit about things, and they are just sure about something that is not really sure, and they are ready to risk it even though it's not sure. But the word of God is called the sure word of prophecy. So when he told you to journey, he was telling you to journey in faith. He wasn't telling you to journey in fear, because if the prophet journeyed in faith, he would have found himself in a better place and not the cave. Slap someone and say, get out of the cave, you. Get out of the cave. Get out of the cave. There's no reason why we should be in the cave as the children of God. No matter how bad it is, and no matter how loud the voice of Jezebel is, don't let the voice of Jezebel push you into the juniper experience. Don't let the voice of Jezebel push you into the cave where it's so dark that you make dark decisions and you become a victim of dark decision. Because the word of the Lord is so powerful tonight. I don't know how many of you have made journeys from juniper to the cave, and you have not been walking with faith or walking with the word, and you are just walking based on the voice. Things that are logical, things that are smart. I got a word for you today, that the voice of the Lord is coming to you in that cave, and he's going to shout you out of that place. He's going to ask you, what are you doing here? You don't belong here. You are the king. You are the prophet of the Most High God. You are the child of the Most High God. You are the head and not the tail. You are above and not beneath. You are loaded with righteousness and blessings of divinity. You have no reason to be here. Even though you look like you failed, and this quarter, this clay has made your hands, and it has gotten spoiled. He said, I got word, I got power to bring you out of that cave. I'm going to find you in the darkest place. I don't care how shapeless it is in that cave. I don't care how formless it is in that dark place. But the word of the Lord is coming tonight. It's the word of his power, and it's going to bring you outside the cave. I got news for somebody. You have one more journey, and it's a journey outside the cave. You have one more journey, and it's a journey outside the cave. The cave of failure, the cave of darkness, the cave of destruction, the cave that makes you say, I don't think I can go further. I think this is who I am. No, that's not who you are. But there is a voice crying even from your spirit tonight, and that's the voice of the Lord. Look at someone, say, I hear the voice of the Lord. Oh, glory to God, somebody. The Bible said, what are you doing here? In other words, the cave is not part of faith journey. The cave is not meant to be part of it. That I didn't tell you to journey 40 days to come here. I told you to journey to the next level. I told you to journey to the second creation. I told you to journey and make it again. I told you to journey and mold it again. I didn't tell you to come here and stay in the dark place. Look at someone say, the Lord did not tell you to do this. You know, a lot of times we try to spiritualize things. The cave looks like a religious place that you can stand and just say, the Lord, I'm going. Come on, just picture seeing a prophet like Elijah in a cave after all the miracles that he had done. You want to look at him and say, wow, this must be God. You know, sometimes you don't understand, it's a mysterious God. No, God ain't mysterious. Hallelujah. God's not a mysterious God. You can understand God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You just have to think like him. Praise God. You know, so the word of the Lord came to him and said, what are you doing here? Go out and stand on the mountain in verse 11. And then said, then a great powerful wind. Hallelujah. He said, a great powerful. Please give me a verse 10. Give me a verse 10. He said, and the Lord you passed. He said, a great, and 11, please. He said, and he said, go forth. Some say, go forth.
Go forth.
Because as we go next. Move on to the next level. He said, go forth, stand upon the mountain before the Lord. You know, he said, go forth and stand forth. Push somebody around you and just push and say, go forth. No, some of you don't know, these are prophetic things. No? Push that person. You know, listen, people come to church and pretend the Lord. Even when this is their destiny, this is a moment for them, they still pretend like, I don't have a problem. You got problems. If God is telling you to teach this, you got problems. Hallelujah. And so what you got to do is you got to help your neighbors. Push him with a prophetic hand. I said, go forth. Say, yeah, you. Go forth. Get out of here. What are you doing in the cave? What are you doing in this cave? This tearful day and this pitiful pit party. Eh? What are you doing there? Look at someone say, what are you doing? Get out of this place. Hallelujah. Woo, glory to God. And the Bible says the wind began to blow. And the Bible says, I love the way he puts it, said, the wind break in pieces the rocks before the Lord. The wind blew, boom. And the Bible says that they broke the mountain. How many of you know what mountain is? So this is a strong wind. Hallelujah. It's got a lot of impact. Not just on paper. So I don't know what it would do to paper if it does that to the wind. I mean to the mountain. He broke it into pieces. Not only that, he said, I said, piece the rocks before him. And the Lord was not in the wind. Isn't it awesome that the things that breaks and so noisy and sometimes very impactful, and people can say, wow, this thing really affected this woman, though. Yet God is not in it. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you what that means, because some of you are wondering, what does that mean? Yeah. God is not in it. Because I say, I've gone through a lot of winds and storms and fires. Say, the Lord was not in them. It wasn't God trying to teach me anything. It wasn't God trying to train me with fire. Are you hearing what I'm saying? God was not in it. You know what the revelation is here? If God is not in the fire, that means that fire is subject to you. Because when God is in something, it means that he's in support of it. When God, look at you, you're not hearing me. The fire that is burning in your life right now is not supported by God. You know when they say, this is not supported, or it's supported by, you know, when they say it's powered by, the fires of our lives are not powered by God. And because, but that's not the revelation. The revelation is because they are not powered by God, they don't have the Almighty on their side. And because they don't have him on their side, they are bound to fail. They are bound to fail. Because no matter how big the wind is, no matter how crazy, and it spoils and destroys the mountain. Mountains are natural stuff. Molten magmas of many years. And now the mountain comes and they went into pieces. Some of you have seen things in your life. You built it so much and it's so beautiful that just one moment everything just got spoiled. Oh my God. No, no. If they broke and they burnt everywhere down, the word of the Lord says God is not in them, so they don't have a life to sustain the victory. They cannot win. So if they broke this, that means there is a molten magma somewhere released by God, because this is no more. This is so. This idea of I want to claim it back. You don't need to claim nothing back. It's been broken, and it's been broken to pieces by the wind that blew the last seasons of your life. But the news is that God was not in them, and God is still not in them when they blow in our life, and that makes them inferior to us. I refuse to allow winds to control me. Let them break every mountain they can break. That doesn't mean I don't have God on my side. Are you hearing me? So it can be so loud and so fiery that it can break the whole mountain, and yet God is not in it. And the Bible says God was not in the earthquake. I don't know what has shaken you in these last few months of the year. I don't know if this greater light is just fun for you, or you've just been fighting some demons. But the truth is, at the end of the day, we're going to fight a good fight. And when everybody's not, no one is going to escape that. He said the Lord was not in the earthquake. I don't know what has been quickened. I don't know what has been thundering. I don't know what has been firing. I don't know the wind that's been blowing. I don't know whether it's the east or the north wind. Whatever the wind is, don't allow anybody to deceive you that the Lord is in it. Because if the Lord is in it, it means you can't do anything about it. But if the Lord is not in it, it means that the most powerful person on earth is not in support of this. And because he's not in support of this, this has to come down. This has to change. This is not the end. Talk to somebody and say, I'm preaching to you tonight that this is not your end. Woo, glory to God. God was in small, still voice. What does that mean? Does that mean God is speaking at his ear? No. No. He says small. Does that mean God doesn't say much? He's a big man. I've seen people say things like that before. God is a big man. He doesn't say a lot of words. Yeah. But the last time I checked, when I was about to give up on myself, He was talking every moment of the day. He's a talkative God. He's a talkative. Because some of you are discouraged. How can he be the big, powerful voice? I would have loved that remedy, right? Because it just tells you God is powerful. God is powerful. But look at this. The Bible says that God was in what? The small, still voice. The small, still voice. It is small. The word small here is dwarf. You've seen a dwarf before. To be short. To be thin. And the reason why it is small, dwarf, or thin, is because it is contested with another voice. Are you here? When Elijah heard the earthquake and the fire and the wind breaking the rocks, just picture it. It's worse than Nepal. This is earthquake 10.1. Are you hearing this? So he was hearing it all at the same time, and then God was speaking at the same time. So when God begins to speak at the same time, you know, in your spirit, you are the one to turn down the volume.
Yes.
I said, Lord, why is your voice small at this time? He said, no, son, I am shouting at the top of my voice, but this man is increasing the voice of Jezebel so he can hear me. I said, Lord, you should shout at this time. He said, I can't shout more than this. I can't shout more than this. It is small because it's contesting with the voice of the earthquake and the boisterous winds, and it's contesting with every other voice around you. He said, one jot of my word would not go without being fulfilled. One, he didn't say one sentence. That's a big one. Jot of my word. It means every breath, everything, God, that came out of his mouth, glory to God, has to come to pass. Everything, even without the statement, just the breath alone. He said his voice, divided the flame. His voice is like many thunder or many winds or something like that. You know, the word of God is not just, you know, you hear it, he can break through anything, praise the Lord. He can move, he can break every partition, he can tear the veil, he can move through. Look at someone say, the word is moving through me. Say, the word is moving through me. Hallelujah. The Bible said, the Lord is not, listen, Lord is not, now in verse 13, he said, and there came a voice. There is a voice tonight, hallelujah. I don't know how many times earthquakes or whatever has happened in your life, but the Bible said in verse 13, he said, and there came a voice. That means that this man was not listening to God all the while. He said, there came a voice. There came, give me verse 13. He said, give me verse 13. He said, and so it was that I heard, and he wrapped his face. So all the while he wasn't hearing God. All the while he was just hearing pa-po. That was all he was hearing. And he was trying to get cover here and there. But the Bible says he came to a part. It was so when Elijah heard it. Look at someone say, you gotta hear it tonight. It was so. I wish somebody would go with that testimony. I say it was so that Pastor Tommy heard it. It was so that Pastor Timmy heard it. It was so that she heard it. It was so that he. Look at someone say, I hear it tonight. The moment you hear it, you said you went out. He went out. Out of where? Out of the cave. Out of where? Out of the failure. Ooh, out of where? It came out of that thing that held him or how about? He said, I don't want hard no more. I don't want him. I don't want that. I don't want this. I want me to move to the next level. And the Bible says that he went out and stood in the entrance of the cave. And behold, a voice came to him and said, "What doest thou here, Elijah?" He asked him again. The appraiser has to go on again because I have to know that you are convinced.
Yes.
And he said, "I've been zealous. I've been, you know, and no one is. Give me the next verse, verse 15. You're gonna like this one. What is it? What is it? Is it? I'm the Lord. Can we read it together? One, two, ready? Read.
And the Lord said unto him, "Go home.
To God." I know this is still very theological for some people, but you get it now. They go, he said, and the Lord said unto him, "Go back." The word "go" here is actually "go back." Go back to the way you were coming from. Your 40 days and 40 nights, you did it hearing all the voice and just going. Then you got to a place that the word God would have had you halted, because that was where the blessing was. Some of you have passed by where God wanted you to really be, because you passed by that place in annoyance of the failures of the past and the things that you didn't get right. And you just went and said, "No, he's here." I said, "Okay, is he here? All right, is he here?" You know, and I said, you can't move into your next level grudgingly. You can't move into your next level the way, because of what was going on. You gotta move with the voice. Hallelujah. Look at this. The Bible says that he went out of the cave and he stood at the entrance of the cave. And the Bible said the voice spoke to him and told him, "Go back to the way you're coming from." Some of you have to go back. Look at them, say, "Go back."
Go back.
Look at three other people and say, "Go back."
Go back.
Go back. You know, some of you, you think you have done a lot of things wrong. But God said there's some things that you did right that you gotta do right. Keep doing it right. You've gone past the stuff. And God said, "Go back and do it right. Go back and do it right. This is not where the blessing is. You have journeyed in fear, but now your faith has come. So find the right place." You hearing this? And he went looking. Hallelujah. And the Bible says, everything, oh, look at this. God told me, he said, everything. Oh, look at John. Look, go to John. We're going to love John tonight. John, chapter 1. John, chapter 1. Just give me John. Give me John. Anyone with John? The Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, verse 1, chapter 1. And the Word was God. The Word was with God, right? And it same was in the beginning with God. Verse 3 says, all things. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Look at someone, say, all things.
All things.
Come on, shout. I say, all things.
All things.
How many of you know you don't need anything more than all things?
Yes.
All right, so say all things.
All things.
All things were made by him. Who is him? The Word. So say all things were made by the Word, and without the Word was anything made that was made. Do you like that?
Yeah.
So that's what the Bible says. Say all things were made by the Word. You know what that means? God told me this morning. He said that means that everything in the earth was activated by the voice. Everything you see on earth was voice activated. You know those security doors that just say, but while and the thing just open, and then you knock, it has registered your hand, and you say, "Bowale," and he goes in, and the other guy is coming, and he says, "Bowale." The guy says, "I don't recognize your voice." I said, "Bowale, I don't recognize your voice." You know why? All things were activated by the Word. All things were voice activated. And that means today God is still activating things with his Word. I don't know the shut doors in front of you. I don't know the places that you knocked that didn't open. I don't know the places that you are seeking and you're not finding. But the voice of God can activate those things, and it's activating it tonight in the name of Jesus. If you believe that, shout amen.
Amen.
Things were activated by God, by the voice of God. He activated it without touching anything but by his Word. That means anything can be touched tonight by his Word. Hallelujah. The voice created you. Look at someone say, the voice created you. And the voice can activate you. So this is what I think the potter did. He looked at the clay. Then he released the Word into the clay. And he said, "I know you were dead and you were destroyed and shapeless right now. But I declare that you are coming back to your shape. You're going to be a beautiful bottle, a beautiful shaped vessel that men will love and care and whatever about." And so that voice brought about the new creation. Are you hearing this? That was why it was important for Jesus to speak at the cross, because his voice was activating something. forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. That moment, God doesn't have the right to actually put the sin of man in front of a man. Because Jesus, the word already said, forgive them, Father. Are you hearing this? When he said, it is finished, what he said is, there's no reason for them to labor anymore in law. Now they are under a new government. So they are going to labor into my rest. And so now there's remaining rest for God's people. Are you hearing this? So the moment, that's why he had to say those things. It was a conversation between him and God. Because his father, because they both knew about the power of the voice of words. And so when he spoke those words, he covers everybody in the world. And the people that will be born 75 generations to today, he has already died for them, because the voice said, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. And the Bible says to Elijah, you go back to where you're coming from. Some of you left the place of prayer. Some of you left the place of worship and obedience to God's word. Some of you started throwing tantrums about the things that are not good on your flesh. You are struggling to move on because you just didn't like that something failed. You are not ready to see what God is preparing for the future. And so you are wondering, how am I just going to forget it like that? But God said, I have prepared something new for you. He was looking for men and women that would say, we love church and we want to come to your church. We are no more serving Baal. But God said, I have prepared 7,000. He said, I have prepared 7,000. But how is God going to prepare them? He's going to activate them through his voice. And he said, you know what? You go back and you will find yourself a king. Azazel was not born as at that time. He will be born 20 something years later after Elijah died. But yet God activated the place of Azazel so that in the generation of Azazel, even if he wanted to be a lawyer and he wanted to be a teacher, no, he had to be a king because he had been activated. Some of you need to know that you have a destiny that has been voice activated. And so as a result, even when you fail and you crumble and you fall, you got to rise because you know it has been activated. Somebody needs to know tonight that Azazel was a voice activated king. Somebody has to know that Elijah was a voice activated prophet. Somebody has to know that Jehu was a voice activated slayer, because God has the power to create kings and thrones before you see them. God has the power to activate kings and rulers before you ever see them. Before there will ever be a Hazael, there had to be an Elijah. And he said, you will find Elijah, the son of Shaphat. You will find him in a location. Somebody's about to locate something because the voice has activated it tonight in the name of Jesus. You're about to locate Elijah. Elisha will be somewhere and the voice will come. Somebody needs to reduce the volume of Jezebel's voice. Reduce the volume of that demon and increase the volume of the word of God. And put it in your ear and meditate on it. And you go back to your prayer. Go back to your worship and you will find the activated creation. There's an activated future for you. And it's in the word of God. Put your hands on your belly and begin to declare the word of the Lord tonight. Come on, somebody. There's one place that only you can enter. There's one place. There's one ministry that only you can do. There's one kingdom that only you can be the king. There's one place that only you can be the ruler. Come on, rise to your feet. Rise to your feet. There's one place that only you can be the ruler. There's one place that only you can be the prophet. The voice has been activated. Don't let the noise of Jezebel fool you. Don't let the noise of your lecturers fool you. Don't let the noise of what you're going through fool you. You have a voice activated future. You have a voice activated kingdom. You have another choice. Don't let any failure of the past make you think you don't have another choice. That's a lie of the devil. Come on, somebody, you need to shout and reduce the volume of the Jezebel tonight. Increase the volume of the word of faith in you. Come on, somebody.
speaks against you, and they try to talk you down, and the voice of failure and the voice of a broken life, the voice of a broken vessel begins to holler at you. You look at them and say, your voice cannot walk on me. Your voice cannot activate fear in me. I got faith in me. The word of the Lord has activated faith and possibilities in front of me. This cannot be the end. Somebody pray tonight. The earth is the Lord and his fullness thereof. Everything in the earth has been activated. Some of you have watched it, heathen. You've seen their success and you wonder, when would I ever be in this level? You've seen their success story and you say, Lord, I don't know what's going on, but the Bible says the earth is the Lord. He created it with his voice. And that means that I'm working for you. The voice that comes from above is greater than the voice that's coming from the cave. The voice that's coming from your spirit is greater than the voice that's coming from man. The witness of man is nothing compared to the greater witness of the Holy Ghost in your spirit. You got to learn how to follow God. Somebody needs to move away from the juniper tonight. Somebody needs to move away from the cave tonight. Somebody needs to move into the place where there is so much light. Somebody needs to call in today. Somebody needs to say, Lord, I'm tired of being in this place. I'm ready to eat again. I'm ready to eat the bread. I'm ready to eat the divine bread of the Word of God. I'm ready to journey even to the next level. I'm ready. I'm not moved by my past. I'm not defined by my past. My definition of the future lies in what the Word of God says. My definition of the future lies in the promises of the Lord. The Bible calls them precious promises. There is no earthquake can spoil it. There is no wind can take it away. Somebody needs to glorify God tonight and say, I thank you, Lord, because I'm on my way out of the cave. I'm on my way to the next level. Somebody needs to move to the next level. I hear the word next in my spirit. Come on, somebody, you gotta move. You gotta move out of here. The plow is over. Somebody needs to move. The reins have come and gone. So what are you gonna do about it now? Some people, I hear your success is what is distracting you. Your success is the reason why you can't move on again. You are stuck in one place. You are stuck somewhere. And God said, you are nowhere, you are somewhere. The word destiny is from the word destination. There is a destination that you got to be. There is a place that you got to be. You belong to a place greater, better than this. Come on, somebody, open your mouth. Consecrate yourself. Declare tonight.